No, we're taken care of, thank you.
You want to ask the first one?
So, how's it like to be back in America? Just spent some time there. A while ago.
Very long time.
Yeah, a few years.
What do you think of the immense posthumous popularity and kind of legendary status Ben has achieved during your hiatus?
It's not like posthumous.
Well, I mean, from the original. Whatever. I mean, since the original band broke up, it seemed like the popularity of the band just mushroomed. Like, well,
it's nice. It's debatable how much of it is because people like records more. How much of it is just somebody else is so bad.
And we had another band out there doing a lot of publicity for us.
Quite a few other bands.
Yeah. What do you think of all of those bands?
We don't.
What about any of the Sisters Invitations that first popped up? Like the Yellow Yellow Glory,
one of those kind of bands.
You don't like any of them?
Well, it doesn't really pinch my consciousness very much.
Okay.
What about, like, all the, I was curious. Every time I go into a record store, there seems like there's a new Sisters bootleg. You know, there's like a million different ones. What do you think about that?
It's going to be a massive plate starting in the conference. I can still feel the scars of plate starting in the conference. Personally, that's true. I wouldn't mind if those records sounded good or if we played good, but we didn't play well enough, often enough to make that whole industry worthwhile.
I saw you guys on the Top of the Pops in America year like a month ago, and you had a backing band with you. You know, I read before that you didn't think you were going to tour. Does this mean you might?
Well, we didn't have a backing band. We had some friends on stage with us.
Oh. So you're still planning on not touring live?
Not for another year or so.
Did you really dislike that? I mean, the grind of touring across the country or whatever?
So many people that want to see the band live.
Yeah, but most of those are people that have seen the band before, you know, and until you can give them something better than you gave them last time, why do it? It's an insult.
Yeah.
Well, especially if it detracts from whatever you're about to write.
Right.
Which, you know, I think it really will be. Mm-hmm. We spent a long time making records, we spent a fair amount of time promoting them, just by doing interviews and TVs and stuff.
We'd waste a lot of time by doing it.
Do you have any more recordings planned already or anything?
We'd like to. We've just finished getting the second single together. We'd like to get the work on the next album as soon as possible. This last record is the album that's finished in October.
Mm-hmm.
And it'll be April before we get a chance to do the next album. This does really long.
Were you both pleased to have the Fourth Amendment come out?
Yeah. I know the record company was very keen to have it out before Christmas. That wasn't such a big issue for us. I think we didn't mind it necessarily. It's been a couple of weeks ago. But we have to let go sometime. Everybody seems to sit back in the
same. You're pleased with the results? You like what you hear?
Yeah.
That you learn from it to the next one. And when it was done, both of us, it just makes you realize the next one will be better.
Right. Is the band going to change at all between, because it's definitely a difference in sound between the old Sisters and the new, and you know, and that's not just because of the departure of.
No, we deliberately got rid of a lot of the guitars, which are just filling up space for no particular reason.
Mm-hmm.
We haven't quite decided what to replace them with or whether to bring something back.
Mm-hmm. I know, I'd like to hear more guitar. I thought the album, you know, it's a great album. That was the thing that was just seemed to be a little bit lacking was that guitar.
Well, most of the songs are written. The this with an acoustic guitar. Mm-hmm. I prefer to write that way because it gives more space for the voice. I don't know how much it's got. It's not quiet. It's really loud. It doesn't come through. Rattling.
Yeah, why do you tend to like put a lot of, on the B sides of the 12 inches, there's the kind of cuts which are just like acoustic guitar, voice, and drum machine. Do you think you ever might do more of that material on albums?
Yeah, I'd really like to. That was the only place I got to put it before, because with the old band, that was the only place I could put it. Everything that goes through is a committee, and a committee being largely comprised of guitar players, electric guitar players. We decide that the songs are always electric guitars.
Do you ever still get, like, idiots suggesting, you know, you should get real drums, and, you know, that kind of thing?
Yeah, not so much in the last couple of years, but increasingly so again with drum machines. It's swung back around to drum machine being a popular. The main worry of people up here seems to be the touring, which seems to be legitimised. So once I've got over that, it's a bitch to like a drummer again. But on the records, nobody cares. The drum machine does it better.
Most bands anyway, with the drummers, still use drum machines when they record their albums.
Yeah, that's true. But a lot of drummers in business. When you guys first got together, the original sisters, just a little bit.
I know.
It's just background.
Wait, okay.
I know, y'all want to hear it. Okay, who is Andrew Eldritch? Let's get to the deep questions then. Put that away. Okay. Why music? What made you choose music instead of anything else?
I didn't. I just fell into it. I think the reason it chose me is because I had very little interest in it. It wasn't something I had a conviction for. I had no training in it. And therefore, I don't have those preconceptions. You know, I pick up a guitar, I don't automatically play blues runs on it. It doesn't make a big difference to the instrument. I think that's always what I want to hear. Somebody else's record. I don't know what they can play John do. Most of the time, you hear other people's records, and all they seem to be trying to do is convince you that they can play John if you're good. Very well if you let them. There's a lot of records seem to be made by people like those weird types in guitar shops who are not really interested in selling you the guitar but seem to be there to show you how well they can play it.
We're more interested in the songs.
I'd read that Jude had a diplomatic career before, or you were planning on one before.
It looked like I was. I had that sort of background, that sort of training, the sort of things that you want to do. To do that, I did. Yeah. It never occurred to me not to.
How did you two, meet and decide to work together?
We were on a tour together years ago. I was in a band called Gun Club.
Yeah.
And we toured. We just met, became friends and stayed friends throughout the years. That's about 5 years ago.
It just
seemed right. We both knew we'd work together one day, but it wasn't planned. It wasn't just when the time was right. It was.
Right after the Sisters fiasco, the original, you formed the Sisterhood as a producer, and the not singing on the album is James Ray.
Yeah, he does. Yeah, various people sang.
You didn't sing at all, though?
No, well, I was trying to make a point with Warner Cop, and I was trying to do something they really didn't agree with. So the record had to go independently. I'm not allowed to sing on other people's records, there are all sorts of details.
That
wasn't like a band was just formed or anything, it was just...
that
someone had to use the name before somebody else.
Wow, so it was more of a political thing than anything else.
Very much.
The music that came out was so good, too.
And it confused a lot of people.
It was more experimental, it seemed, than the stuff like before or after.
Yeah, I think there was a lot of stuff on the GIF, which was indicated on the backs of previous 12 inches.
And it's like a transition record, actually, because a lot of it can be heard on Floodland. How did you come up with that name? How did you come up with the name Floodland?
To sing the natural title after all the songs, because it's obvious that you can always ask several of them, and it was water running through everything. It's a very good thing.
What were you feeling when you recorded this record?
Well, the first time I was there, it was pretty rough.
Throughout the whole year?
We recorded it, basically we recorded it twice.
This wasn't Jim Stein?
No, he just did the track and half. It was also just kind of a track and half. His contribution is great, but it's not something you want to apply liberal doses on track. Captain Africa.
Why did you choose to work with him?
Because when... Because he can get budgets for choirs from record companies.
More politics.
Yeah, I've said the sort of things then before, and they just giggle. They say, you know, what's he really going to spend the money on? You know, what's he really going to spend the money on? He's going to come back and be very happy, very wide-eyed, and he's not going to have made a record.
Is there any truth to that?
Yeah. We've all
heard the rumors about
you. I'm quite responsible really? In these regards. I do like making records more than being happy and wide-eyed.
Still, record under the influence of hallucinogens. I mean, the early records had a very acid kind of feel to them.
I haven't taken any acid in the 1980s at all.
Really?
No, I don't think it would be very, dangerous thing for me.
I remember when you were recording First and Lost in Always or something, there was a lot of things in the press about how you like freaked out or something.
I was very sick. I had a blood sugar problem. I think you can hear it in the record. The voice sounds like the voice of a sick man.
Side two. Side two.
I know a lot of people like that, but it is very strong.
Speaking of, you were talking about the water, he mentioned the water things. I was curious if like you had any kind of feelings towards that, meaning that would give you an obsessive thing to name the album. Like, are you afraid of water, or do you find it fascinating?
Well, yeah, both. I've grown very attached to it since I moved to home, which is important. I've always been very impressed by this, certainly now you can feel it's something you have to have respect for.
Do you think that ever comes out in music at all? Because I've always found your music very, like, flowing. Has kind of like a washing quality to it. It washes over you, kind of. Is that?
I like to think of it as suitably linear and sort of hypnotic. The record company tell me it's linear. it's very fun with that wave-like repetition.
Yeah.
It's when you got off.
It's something like the Reptile House has a real, like, you can just put that on and float with it. It's just got a real mantra-like quality because the songs are all really long and very slow.
I recorded a lot of things for that record. And then in the mix, put all the reverb on and then took the original noise out. So a lot of that record is just like pure reverb, everything on it.
Which is interesting. Do you think any of the old stuff will ever get released, say, compiled and released on CD? We would all love to have digitally mixed.
I don't think it would sound any better, but I mean, you just get the same rough mixes without the crackles of vinyl. And I know how those records originally sounded. Cover a multitude of sins. It's possible, but I don't think now's a good time to do it. I think it would be like putting up a gravestone. I don't have the time for it.
particularly you formed the label?
We can find anybody else to put the records out at the same time, so we just got one. It's not that hard if you have to do it. For years I used to get that as well, so how do you do it? So there's really no answer, you just have to get up and hear and
do it. Because
it doesn't take money. I mean, we started off with, we made the first record with one guitar, a cheap borrowed drum kit, a 7-watt practice amp. Everything on the record was like that. We had like, £50. And everything was gone out back in, and that was really hard. That was a couple of years. Gradually got used. It was something like 3 years before anything else on that track.
So
I don't think many people have the patience anymore.
Were you just like helping out bands like the Violets and Salvation?
Were they all on Merciful Release?
Yeah.
Because there's an inconsistency between the numbers of the records, and we can't find the missing sequence of numbers.
We start off with 7 because it sounds good, so then we go straight to 13.
Write that down, I'll never find Merciful Release. 6. Rebirth Records, is that the Violets, or is that part of...
They tried to initiate the approach.
Black Paris. What happened with that?
There was a period of about a week where the sisters were going to be called the Paris Riots. There's some tenuous connection between that and that Paris, but I can't remember anymore.
So were there any other bands released on Rapacki release besides the sisters?
Well, there's a band at the moment called Jack's Right, the performance. The two guys from Newcastle and stand in the back, and it's all a pop thing. That was out, I think, it's the band.
A band?
Like an
America?
Well, no, I mean, we've done a lot of work with them, hung out with them a bit, and because they have records out, and that's always, we thought it would be just nice to take them to Top of the Pops. Is something that you don't get to do in England unless you're either really tacky or you've spent a long time working. So it's just like a nice treat to be able to take these guys to the studio and show them what it was like, you know, because sooner or later they're going to be doing it in their own right, and might as well get a thing of it now. Being on TV is
any coincidence that James during performance sounded a lot like you?
Yeah. Because they sent us a tape which we liked. A lot of people sent us tapes which we don't like. And it wasn't the fact that the guys were maritime, which had anything to do with it. Their tape was just very, very good. Other people sent tapes which were very, sounded very different to the sisters. Try to do something with it, it's like the medias. So we do. Whatever it's called, casting traces, that's what they say.
Weren't you going to try once? I remember hearing an interview with you here on a New York radio station like 4 years ago or so, and you were going to try to license stuff like, what's that band? Some like 60s type of I was band from around here, like I think it was.
Yeah.
The Chesterfield Kings or those bands.
Yeah, but they wouldn't come out of Rochester. They really live it to the floor. Pretty bold people. They're doing really well like that. And True West, I wanted to put True West records out, but they write something else, which suited them much better, so it works for them.
Do you think you ever might somehow...
No, I don't have so much time. I mean, the operation is still basically just two people, so...
Do you think you might ever some sometime release any of the sisters, old sisters' material that never got issued, like Good Thing or Teachers, or Knocking on Heaven's Door.
I fancy having another crack at Teachers one day, but I think the reason that song was screwy in the first place was Knocking on Heaven's Door, so I know there's a live video from the album hall. Yeah. So that's sort of how this is. Emma is about to come out as a piece of the album.
Really?
Just a minute.
Yeah. That's the only outstanding song, I think, which we've heard. Yeah, I think this one's too fine.
I saw a record the other day when I was in the city here, and it was two songs that were two mission songs. It said on it that you had sung with one of them, and I know you've said that you didn't like singing Wayne's lyrics, and his lyrics are kind of corny compared to yours. I was wondering if, you know, if that was one of the reasons why the original one broke up.
Yeah.
It was Dancing on Glass and Garden of Delight, and it said vocals Andrew Eldritch on one of them.
Yeah, when just before the band broke up, Wayne had this song that he did, but I had to go and sing. I think if you listen to that bootleg, you'd be able to see. I mean, I can't sing it with conviction, so it doesn't mean anything. Mm-hmm. When I had a go, so I didn't try, but I rewrote part of it. And I was still trying to make it make some sort of romantic sense, but I couldn't still have a meaning of it. And, in fact, I think they put it out. It was originally going to be a something like Sisters B-side. It was going to make Wayne sing. Try and mix the notes down low enough so people wouldn't notice it didn't mean anything. I think it ended up as a Mission A-side, which I think says a lot.
Are you ever in touch with Gary Marks at all? Or is he...
No, he's got a rather... He's got a lawyer with a rather strange sense of humour, so...
Him too?
I don't blame him personally. He doesn't know a lot about...
I was curious.
It's hard to say who's responsible for writing this to you, so I'm both talking to him. I think he just went to his lawyer and said, well, demand something. I must have been ripped off somewhere. And the guy's still fishing, you know, but he fishes without any time to do something. So
I was curious about him because it seemed like there was more. It was easy to see why you were having problems with Wayne, let's say, but I, you know, what was the reason that Gary kind of didn't work out, because he seemed like he'd been with you much longer.
Yeah, that hurt me. The stuff Wayne didn't really hurt. That was just a drag. I quite enjoyed some of the battles. Just the guys that
I can see where he comes from being associated with the jerk from Dead or Alive. You can see he's got that attitude already, because Pete Burns is
he wants the biggest asshole in the famous. It's not too bad. Whereas Gary was a sharper sense of emotion and values.
It's a shame because
I think he found a girlfriend, he moved out of town, which is found that we weren't really talking to each other anymore.
He's got no career in music and the Ghost Dance records were.
Well, I think they're doing quite. I mean, I keep. Every time I go back to England, I hear things like, oh, I'm sure Ghost Dance are about to get signed.
They keep playing.
Yeah.
They're still going. You can go to see them, but I saw it. And it's just pretty uninspired.
Yeah. I mean, I didn't think the record was bad. It was just kind of
some of them were good, some of them were bad.
Well, live, I mean, the girl is happy to be there. She's so happy to be on that stage. But you know what I mean? There's no soul to
it. Yeah, that's
desperate something.
You're from Skull.
She's got a lot of things going for her, but she's her own worst enemy. If I was a music industry jerk, which of course I'd be inclined to say that they missed their main chance at the time at which they should have made some sort of transition. But you know, that anybody writes a great song, that their time's going to come again. You know, I've always been just down to songs.
What do you listen to?
You
Algon, do you listen to anything?
I'm very fond of Algon. I really like it. I very hard to stop playing catching.
Really?
Yeah, which I think is very fun.
You hate it? I love it. I like it. I think that we're lyrically sharp.
Yeah.
I know what I was going to ask. It seemed, it was weird, when you were done doing interviews here, like, years ago, you always used to, like, annoy the DJs and stuff by having to play Led Zeppelin and stuff.
Yeah.
What do you feel about the fact that now everybody else, you know...
Well, I'm going to go to Toronto next week for a radio show.
I don't play,
made him play Stevie Nicks and Led Zeppelin on Friday. After the album.
After playing, like, the Albert Hall, do you find that you wouldn't want to go back to playing, like, smaller places again? Could you ever see yourself, if you ever did play live,
yeah,
would you be, like, an arena-type band?
I think so, although we'd probably pick arenas like the Albert Hall. Because the time we played the Albert Hall, we were very lucky. It wasn't, like, a regular event. It was a very special gathering. Okay, there was like, I don't know how many people, 5,000 or 6,000 or something. But it was very much a sort of family communion thing. And the place seemed very small on the night because it was just like us and a few friends. And the fact that there had to be 5,000 or 6,000 with these close friends didn't seem to make it at all.
We're all social thing.
Yeah.
I read in some of the English press that you did. They never wanted to play the same venue that the old band had ever played. They wanted to play new, different kinds of venues.
Oh, I certainly don't want to.
If it comes about that you're a tour. I think that's a cool idea to play.
I don't remember saying that in so many words, but it's... Yeah. There's a lot to be said for that. I mean, certainly I don't have anything about it playing. I just feel... Their whole country was like, they didn't want to get anything.
The Albert Hall, though, I mean, if you went there, you would think it was really small. I mean, it's my understanding it's small, but obviously there have been these incredibly huge arenas and things, and the Albert Hall is a small place, but
I
understand.
I mean, this is used to place like 15, 20,000 people at the time in arenas in Belgium. Most of those two seem like that.
To get some background on you, because you're still kind of enigma to most of the press, I think. Your first band was The Bags, right? But I was curious if you did you record, were you still in the band when Legal Weapon made their first debut?
Yeah.
So I
that came out despite me.
I
fought and screamed and yelled, but it came out anyway.
I noticed you were writing credits on that.
Yeah.
Because I have it someplace, but it's got a big hole bitten out of it because it's really rare, so somebody gave it to me. Saved it, even though I can't play it. But how did you, like, you were originally based in California.
Yeah.
How did you get into it?
Well, I just, I don't know, but I had,
That long for coffee.
He asked for that one. I saw an ad in the paper, it said, drummer into Mahavishnu Orchestra and Ramones. I knew it was for me, so I called them and just got them back to get to The Bags. I just did that as a joke, but as usually happens with these musical jokes, people really liked it. Next week we had, you know, the whiskey, and then we kept going, we've got to change this name. This name is so bad, but it just kept going. So finally they kicked me out. They told me I was too much of a rock star, and that they wanted to be a serious dance band. That was going on.
Is this such a thing? Is this serious?
I was pretty horrified. So I was booted out, and then I tried to, there was just nothing going on. The only reason, basically, I started Legal Weapon was to get The Bags back. I said, well, we're going to do this and this and this by this date. So 9 months later, I had done everything I wanted to, so I quit Legal Weapon. But I had no intention. I hated the way this was sounding. We were a bar band. I couldn't understand what I wanted to do at all. So I quit, and then there's so many bands asked me to join them, and it used to really, I'd wonder why, because it was like, even now, Thrash and Doves, if you've heard of that band, asked me, and it's like, well, what the hell would I be doing in a band like that? But back then it happened, so until Gun Club, there wasn't anything I wanted to do. But
influence who I worked on with
Jeff Gilbert. He's the biggest asshole on the face of the earth.
He doesn't look at it all.
I think it's quite important to look like an artist, to be able to look like an artist. It's important to realize it when you're doing it. And I think that's what
Jeff opposed to looking like a rock
star. You must have spoken to him sometime.
I don't like Uncut Records a lot. I like his solo album a lot too.
Is that kind of why you guys defected and made Furbible? Because I was always curious. I have that single, but I never heard any information about it. Like, what was that band really about?
That's why I stayed in London. Kit and I had made a pact that I was leaving Gun Club. Everybody knew I was leaving Gun Club for a year in advance. It was just every interview and everything. I hate this man. I'm leaving. So Kit and I started this band, and I thought it was the worst thing I'd ever heard. And Kit thought it was the best thing he'd ever heard. And so, what? And I fought through that whole record. I hate it. I think Fetus, that guy Jim.
Therwell.
Yeah. He produced it, and I mean, listen to it. I couldn't believe it. I was really horrified.
The vocals were pretty awkward.
Abominable. I think it's the word. God, yeah. I made the mistake of leaving the studio because I was going to throw up, and the vocals got way loud when I was gone. I came back.
So do you find it easy working you two with like a two-person framework as opposed to a band?
Yeah. Less people to disagree.
Both have really high standards too, and most people don't. Most people will just do it.
Yeah. So Jeff and I was about to ask him to have a very extra person he had who gets a vote.
That's, I guess, why it's why somebody you take like Jim Therwell works alone. What do you think of him at all?
I've got a lot of respect for what he does, because it's not what I choose to listen to.
No. I think he was amazing. I mean, that's why we had him, because his records sound great. Yeah. And how he did that to us, I really can't understand. I don't know what the point of that was, why he did it like that.
I know, it's a very primitive sounding record. His records sound like incredibly much.
I just compare
him. I mean, it was just a joke. It was really amazing. And when I realized it was actually going to sound like that, and I tried to get it out of him why he was doing this to us, he just blanked me.
Well, he always saw that as Kid's record, he always saw Kid as a person who was totally not musical in my group, and he made a totally not musical record. I mean, it's sort of fair enough, it's just a shame that you had to be named on it.
Yeah.
Well, didn't get that wide distribution, so.
No. God. I mean, I don't care anymore.
I think it's fair enough to do something like that. I don't want to do something like that. It's no shame.
I mean, that was it. Andrew knows that was it. We toured that thing and everything because we did owe money, and it was one of those things we had to get stuck in for a while. Like, paid off the debts basically, and went to the major.
You mentioned about being a rock star and stuff like that, and that was one thing that really was interesting about the press things, like your ideas of what it is to be a conventional rock star and how that applies to you.
Yeah, I think it needs to be that you're the one that you're talking about. I always thought it was important that the message should acknowledge the medium of making it, so it should not distrust rock music in the appropriate fashion, which is anything paradoxically makes it drastically. But I trust people who have an idea of it. I like it with the singing.
Yourself carrying on any kind of tradition, or do you see yourself as
a sort of? I mean, I think it's important to refer to it because it's undoubtedly there. At the same time, it's possible just to step beyond it, not that just supposed to. I always thought that music was together on five or different notes, use the notes in creating your sounds. Fresh.
So that's what makes it useful as a medium for communication. If there wasn't an established language, you could use it to say anything. I have no time for the avant-garde. Very little time for the esoteric in music, music to speak.
Do you think what you do for masses, or do you think you do it for people?
Yeah.
Just, do you do it for yourself, or do you do it for people? You know, the average person on the street to appreciate.
Well, we do it for ourselves, but at the same time, when it's done, just to support the making of the next one, we do try and sort of interest the masses in it to some extent. I don't think there's anything in it which is necessarily going to deter it.
Do you feel this record's going to do really well in the market?
No, I think it could.
I read a few places that you hit in America.
Yeah.
Why?
It's sick. I mean, it's wonderfully sick, and I'm glad it's sick, because I'm trying to straighten myself out, it'd be really boring. But I wouldn't like to live here. I wouldn't like to be brought up here. I wouldn't like to be in America.
What about, we've read a lot about your antipathy to France. What is that?
Well, I mean, I despise everybody, really. It's just the French can talk on the list. The English also are on the list, but they're way down.
They're like Germany.
Yeah, they're on the list. I like Hamburg, which isn't really that much like Western Germany. It's a mistake.
It should have been a city state.
Right? Yeah, I mean, as soon as you go south of Frankfurt, I don't want you to contempt of that. Northern Germany's very progressive. Very austere. Hamburg's different. It's an enclave of something. I always found it very similar to San Francisco. It was the same sort of feel to me. I always thought I could live very long in San Francisco. I still do. It's just a sort of long way away from Europe. Hamburg it is.
Do you prefer living there than in Leeds?
Yes, I don't like the infrastructure in English. It's an art of language. The town just doesn't have those things.
Do you think that there was any reason why a whole bunch of bands that were somewhat similar came out of Leeds at the same time? Is there anything in Leeds that produces
that? Yeah, because I used to lend them my equipment and show them how to use it. You know, like, nobody I knew could afford a drum kit. Nobody I knew could afford any place to go and rehearse with a drum kit. I was the only person doing anything with a drum machine. I brought a bar of mine. I'm tempted to apologize for it, but I don't think I will. It's not my fault, really. Nowadays, we've got all sorts of bits that comprise the doctor. In the old days, it was a succession of cheap rolling machines. Nowadays, there's a sort of computer brain and two noise bits. Stop being a Unitarian.
Dual programming.
It had a different sound on the earlier 12 inches. By the time of the first album, it seemed to be more...
I'm getting the hang of it. You have to bear with me.
Between First and Last and Always, I guess, I read that there was an album already structured.
Yeah.
Called the name. Did any of that appear on Floodland or...
Bits of it. Nothing coherent. And there were a couple of songs which that was very largely a car. I've done Mission Revenge, a car. In that period, one of my friends got rather violently killed. And was sent to the vault. They're in a deep freeze.
was curious about your handwriting, like the and the art you did on the earlier 12 inches was really interesting. Did you have any kind of inspiration for that style? It's very like, it looks very medieval.
I don't know. The only things I failed in school were art and music. So I was in revenge. I failed them very totally. So it's a very hard question to answer.
Did you come up with that the ubiquitous Sisters logo, which has that kind of writing that's on everything?
Yeah.
Was that done purposefully for a reason?
It was the only typeface in the catalogue which was tuned in the appropriate fashion. Now they say everybody uses it, but at the time it was always a rare thing to see on typeface.
Who created the logo of the pentagram and then?
I sort of stole it from various places.
And all the singles covers, they were all on the Yoko Chan. I'm going to have one here.
Yeah, that's the back part of the cover of Billion Dollar Babies.
Oh, really?
Oh, sure.
I never noticed that.
Alice Cooper right there. Oh, man.
It's important to make these little points. I like putting these sort of things in records for you when you find out about 10 years old. It's nice. It's been a little paper. What a great record.
That's one of my favorites.
And, so my favorite thing I like is the cover of Body and Soul.
Dora.
What was that?
Gustav Dora, Dante.
It's a fantastic picture. Fantastic.
I think that's about to come out again in this original package.
Yeah. As what? As a 12-inch? The 12-inch of the same?
I don't know. I think WEA in England are making it available in Canada. They're actually able to re-release it as such, relaunch it. But I just don't know.
Well, it seemed like
I think the art department just really liked the cover, and they were just sad about it. Again. Yeah, right. Which is nice. I got to find the art department.
I remember I had picked that up in the beginning of 84, and it was almost hard to get then. And then, like, then for the last year or two after that, it was possible to find. And then all of a sudden, it seemed like we got a whole slew of them back in here.
That's strange. Maybe someone's put it there. We deleted the 7 inches fairly soon after they were released. Made sure the 12 inches were missed.
Yeah, even those were really hard to find for the longest time. They started cropping up. Go up Town House. Couldn't get for long, and Body and Soul 12 inches. Nowhere. And once they cropped up, they disappeared really quick again.
Do you disown the really early stuff, like the watch and all those kind of things? They don't even sound like the same bands at the time.
Well, no, we were all. There's only two of us, but we were doing different things, like I was playing guitar and stuff.
Even Adrenochrome, Body Electric, or
Gary was. I think that's the first legitimate thing we did. I mean, I remember at the time, I was very proud of it, and so I'm still sort of proud of it, because at the time, remembering how it's done, the resources we didn't have, and difficult circumstances. Quite an achievement to get it out.
That reminds me. I've heard a tape where you do Adrenochrome, and it's like a long version where it goes into Teachers.
That was a demo in 82. Very early 82, I think. We just put it out on cassette. And there were about 100 copies. These things come back to home.
Did you were those originally like linked together like that, or and then
yeah,
later
we
did you separate
it live for a couple of months later? It seemed like a good idea at the time. But then that was before we ever did anything like a tour. Never could. So it's the time that you could get a string of promoters to give you a string of dates in one go. That was kind of my interest. And it was just after that that suddenly we started getting off like three or four nights in a row and being adventurous as we were at the time. We started doing things like those three or four nights in a row that was what we shouldn't do. And it got really hard to play one song and then another without stopping in the middle. You know how it is? So
the earliest thing I've heard is it's two songs. I think it's Sister Ray and 1969, and the date on it was like spring or summer of 81. Was that like when the band first played, or?
That would be. We started doing 1969 on May the 15th, 1981. We only figured to play before.
It's amazing how these people come up with all these things you recorded once. I have a band now, and I'm worried that somebody's going to all of a sudden be putting out God singles that we never realized were available.
You have to be careful.
I see more bootlegs of yours than almost any other band. And you go into the shops and...
You're up there with Springsteen now.
And it's like every week they have a new one out.
You know, supposedly it's one of the top 10 bootleg bands of all time. This is just amazing.
I would definitely agree.
That's what I said to Andrew. Well,
I can't believe that band played so badly so many nights running.
Because there's new ones that keep coming out. You would think that that are going to
be there
at those shows, but they just keep coming out.
So many different ones of Jolene, 7 inches of it. It's amazing. I was always curious about this. I remember seeing you in August of 84 at the Ritz. And you played with Black Flag, which was like such a contrasting style. Yeah.
That jazz.
But I still remember, hearing like, because I recorded it at the time, and you listen back to the tape, there was this guy with a skinhead kept like spitting at you and saying,
"Faggot, faggot."
The guy who's bootlegging them always recording the shows.
I
had to play him a lot.
How did you feel like playing with, you know, on such a strange bill where the audience, like half the audience was very.
I thought it was great. It's so boring when you get to play for the same people all the time. Okay, people who spit usually get a hard time because they come with the mics down end of the bass range. But that's one reason we started playing so much in continental Europe outside of England is that you get to play for a lot of hippies there and you're watching the first people that give you shelter and they know what you're referring to. You don't have to overemphasize anymore.
Germany, somebody told me we were on tour somewhere when I heard that.
It was bizarre. I couldn't be there at that time. Actually, I'm still holding a grudge against you. I was at the time running a nightclub, and you just took my drawer away in one night. One night, you emptied my club.
Well, we must have been giving you a lot of business the last few years.
Yeah.
I remember also at that show, when you came out, like, you were just like, settle down. And I was like curious if you like to control a crowd. Like,
I think it's important that you state them very clearly. You are the audience. We are the band. You do your job. We do ours. I really resent that. That impression that some bands try to give, like that. Like the early Talking Heads used to do. They come on stage and they pretend everybody's in their own farm living room. It's not. There is a barrier there, you might as well build it up a little and make it an entertainment in its own right.
Don't you think that when people are on stage, they can't possibly act like a normal person? Like, there's just, it's a different state of awareness.
Any normal person you put on stage, shine bright lights on their face, and they go, weird. No, I don't.
This man,
I'm in a band right now called God, and we just played. And it's heavy butthole surface, Led Zeppelin influence, and the singer in the band has literally put a line on him and he will do just about anything. It's pretty
and
amazing.
That is normal, because that's what a normal person does if you put them on a stage. I think it's important to acknowledge that.
Do you see a ritual, any kind of ritualistic thing in that where you're kind of like, I mean, in modern life, it seems like you don't have, there aren't many rituals modern man can do.
Yeah, the church.
The primitive kind of things. Do you find that, like, I mean, I always find being, even watching a band or being on stage or anything like that, it's kind of a release because you feel like you're.
I'm part of a ritual.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's certain things that have to happen. I don't feel comfortable on stage unless you've got the stack side, or a certain shape, or a certain size. You know, you have to have a little bit there and a font there. Understood. It's
great.
How do you feel about the, say, the rock star idolatry that fans have? When they look up to you?
Well,
it's like this.
I feel very answerable to them for that, so it doesn't bother me. If that's what they do, then fine. I feel capable of responding to that in a responsible fashion. I resent it when that gets transferred to, I don't know, Huey Lewis or whatever. He's going to give anybody anything in return. His account is probably going to be good. If I send my underwear to Huey Lewis, I don't think he'd take it.
Right. Do you see yourself as, I mean, a couple of years ago it seemed like everybody walking around New York had the black, you know, big black hats and sunglasses, right? I mean, do you see yourself as setting any kind of fashion for your fans? Or?
No, I can't see. I think I've got a hold of something I generally try to stop wearing.
I don't know what I was going to ask before. I was always curious about this. I was in various bands with drum machines, and we used like the Roland TR-707 too, which was kind of close, I thought, to what you guys were using.
Yeah.
But I could never figure out, seeing you too, how did you keep all the songs on one machine? Because it's like most drum machines that you get, they only will hold like a couple of different complete songs.
Yeah, you have to learn how to make certain breaks fit with what you want.
Did you have somebody back there working with it, or did the machine just run completely by itself?
Yeah, we didn't dare try and persuade anybody to have their act sufficiently together to do any mucking about in the middle. No, you had to be able to start and just roll for 45 minutes or whatever and stop. It wasn't until we got the 808 that we managed to get a decent sized set. After that, we've got the DMX, which took on everything was fine.
What about the name of the band? Always interested me because one of my favorite Leonard Cohen songs is Sisters of Mercy. I mean, is that something where you've gotten it from that?
Yeah.
Leonard Cohen fan?
We like the idea of prostitutes being referred to as. We seem to have driven quite a bit of being a prostitute at the same time. So that's pretty much what rock bands did.
How about your name? I read that you were thinking of legally changing it to Eldritch. I mean, is that...
No, I'm thinking of legally changing it to something else, actually. I'll tell you what it is. I don't think we'll be able to find me in the next house.
I didn't. You'd never give up your given born name?
I wouldn't give up Andrew. I've sort of gotten used to it.
Why did you pick Eldritch in the beginning? Did you want to convey a certain image?
I just sort of sounded like me. It does. It's the only name I answer to.
What did you do during
life? There's also a little joke in there, but I'd like to spoil it for you by telling you what it is.
Look that word up in the dictionary.
Oh, Patricia. It's evil.
Well, the funny thing is, it's because a completely different meaning in British.
Really?
Yeah, but in American.
Oh, I guess that might be the joke then.
I've never looked it up in
American. I know you have.
Never seen American dictionaries.
What did you do? Like, it seemed like you'd gone under kind of an exile after the original band broke up and before this edition of the band emerged. What were you doing then?
I got healthy, but exile is the wrong word. Okay, I went to hell, but that's far from exile.
More like a renewal?
Yeah.
Hi, how are you doing? Because we're sort of having to end it soon.
What time is it?
It's like 10
o'clock. Good, I get to get one of the cards,
So you had about an hour.
I know, it wasn't fair.
But we had combined.
He's from 11 to 12, or from 12 to 1.
Yeah, but you were like a half hour late, too. I mean, the thing is that we have another interview at 12:20, or 12:30. So, you know, I could give you like another 10 minutes or so. But you were getting a half hour.
I was getting an hour.
I told you a half hour. And that's all I could do. I'm sorry. I definitely said to you a half hour.
I thought it was an hour.
No, definitely a half hour. So,
we'll go for the rest of the loop.
Yeah, I'll, you know, we'll give you another little while. And,
okay.
See what we can do,
Let's see what else we want to ask then.
Is there anybody else on the album beside the two? Anybody else play on the album?
Only on
or floodlands.
Yeah, this garage's got mostly Jim's friends.
What,
apart from the choir that, and the guy that played them, that stupid guitar stuff, that's not anything that can be done. So it's when Jim feels happy if he's got it done, he will do it. Most of the parts were replaced after that left the studio. Everything else in the career was sort of.
Do you find the gothic tag annoying when people try to
card time.
Say you are?
Come on, you guys are too good. We made up these wonderful cards, and goddammit, you were the first
one.
I didn't even use them all.
When people always say, you know, well, give that impression, yeah. I mean, I don't think.
No gothic.
Yeah, we're sick of that.
It's
we're
over.
Very sick of that, but I think
it's
it'll
over.
Change really soon with the next single, the next video.
Well, and a concurrent thing with that, what do you think of the fact that anticipated by a couple of years the kind of 70s revival thing?
Well, that's all we did. We were just, I think revivals were a bad word for what we did. Sad that other people took that as a cue to have a revival. It was very sad. There's a big difference between referring to those things and using them to make a further ulterior point and just retreading it. Are they giving people what they want? You know, just trying to give people a little bit more than what they want.
This Corrosion video, it's very street and industrial looking. And, I hate to say this, but wet. Yeah, very wet. And I hate to say this, but the only thing I can liken it to is this. I got the feeling that it was like akin to Billy Idol, which is just...
No, it's more like...
It's like the most god-awful thing to say to you. It's like...
It's what you call a melt. Like, you've seen a film called The Devil's Brain.
Yeah, with Ernest Borgnine.
Right, now you remember the end sequence of that?
Yeah, when they all go...
Right, now that's... it's that sort of way. Mm-hmm.
What is that song about? I found the lyrics kind of cryptic. I mean, they're really fascinating, but like, what does the song mean to you?
I was just trying to get other people to stop singing these stupid songs.
How about... Dominion Mother Russia seemed to me kind of a, it had kind of the same themes as Black Planet. Was that something you wanted to continue to write about?
Yeah, well, not particularly, but the things always resume. It's just sort of touches. I can get quite carried away. So Patricia usually answers this
question. Usually.
Well, she does when I'm in America. Well, I like to get the heat.
I noticed that over here, we have a wedding band.
Mm. Is that all?
Are you married?
I was married once, but I got over it. No longer married. I won't do that again.
Are you married?
No. That's a very long, very complicated, very sad story.
Are you two associated in any other form?
No, but we have the same very sad story.
Okay. We'll leave it at that.
Are you people interested in...
Believe it or not.
No, are you interested, like, do you have any interesting things that you like to collect or read or...
I feel rushed. Which reminds me of that hotel.
Well, they're not really very interesting to anybody else, is it?
What you collect?
No. I used to hoard Marlboro packets, I'm not sure. I stopped doing that because it sounds crazy.
Do you have any fears?
Oh, yeah. I discovered a serious fear of heights last week.
And two. We just were in the elevator and it didn't stop at floors and he almost died on it right there. So I'll hold the doors open and jump out before he died.
I overcame my fear of floors since last week.
How Freudian.
No, I just don't like things that are bigger than me and are probably full of intention to kill me.
Are you, uh, do you see yourself as a band that's not afraid to be bombastic when necessary?
Yeah. But I need to make a point about bombasticism. It's stupid. But wonderful, sorry.
Yes.
I think it's important to be able to do that and to show once in a while that you can, particularly with this corrosion, because we've been away a long while and through this event to come back. Because that's the reason why they let you do something wrong. It's an easy track to get stuck in.
Is there anything else you have plans forthcoming that people are interested to know about? Do you have any kind of ground plan for the next year or two?
We'd really like to get the next album written and made now this year. That's going to happen. Since we've got plans for whatever it's going to be for the next 6 months, that's going to take all that time. Hopefully, rather than get distracted by the same.
Right. So for now, the big promotion is going to be moving Floodland and conquering of America on lots of records.
Well, the thing is, Floodland's already done rather well in a lot of other places, and America really got the tail end of it this time, largely due to the attitude of the record company. And it must be said that whether it does well here or not, it's really not a major concern.
But I do take it really personally, because I am American, and I think it's a great record, and I think it can do really well
here.
And when I have record companies telling me, for whatever reasons, that it just isn't, I mean, it's bullshit.
It is bullshit. Because there's...
It's too easy.
I mean, I've got
some of the songs we work on radio, I just don't, but the ones that do, like this Corrosion.
But you know, there'll be a next one, and there'll only be a next one if we get on with it and stop worrying about whatever's not happening with this one.
Yeah, that's when I was home at Christmas, and it's just this very depressing sort of feeling going, we could have had it, but we didn't.
Do you have anything you want to ask us? Any questions you want to ask us? Being Sisters of Mercy fans in New York.
Yeah, you should tell people actually to write the record company if they want the English packaging of the record, which is always better than the American packaging. The Americans can just repackage everything. They have less bits, they have such good pictures, they chop and change everything.
Yeah, I have the important
Andrew, do you want to continue on here while I go to the other thing? Because all we need really is Patricia, so
sure.
If you guys want a little bit longer.
That would be great.
Okay, great. Okay. We're getting 3 articles out of this.
Yeah,
I
don't want.
Thank you.
It was nice meeting you, Patricia.
Nice meeting you.
Drag out the questions, eh?
Yeah, I had some more.
Yeah, I noticed that the, it was always the same thing, all American packaging is correct. We own import records like crazy and no American records.
I spent a long time in the art room sorting these things out in England. I had to fight very hard.
Even the packaging, I mean, I remember I bought the import when the week it came out of First on Some Always, because the American one, I knew it wasn't going to be as good. And then when I saw it without the gatefold, I was like, how cheap. How cheap.
Yeah, but the Elektra did put out a really good promo package with that. I really like that. The tune in term, I dropped it. I thought that was pretty cool.
They have to be pushed all the time, you know, and because I'm not that worried about American success, I don't push them as hard as I ought to. I think it's really up to public to demand it.
Definitely.
I wish I had more of that, but the people did demand. Because it's there to be had, you know, it's not like they couldn't, but just a little bit more effort put out. It's very important. People buy fewer and fewer records, and it's very easy to see why. And it is expensive.
Yeah.
I never ever had a record player in my life, because it's far too expensive. I can never afford to buy records. Even though I never had a record player, it's certain. I've bought about 12 albums in my life. I can't remember what they were now.
What are they? What are the 12 albums? That would be interesting.
Well, I deliberately lied about being able to know what I meant. It's really important that it should be something that's great to fund. You know, if you're going to buy that thing, it better be worth it.
You often get compared to a lot of the classic, like late 60s, early 70s bands, like, you know, the usual Stooges, Doors, Velvets type things. Do those, I mean, even in your press kit, do those kind of things?
Yeah, I didn't see that, I guess. No, I was
curious.
I don't think that sort of thing should get thrust in front of intelligent people. There are obviously some radio stations in Little Rock to whom you have to send those sort of things.
film. But it can't be a band on your own. You have to be like fans of someone else.
The best you can hope for is that every time you put a record in the campaign, something different and they're confused and over the target so much that it ceases to be an issue. But that's what we always figured to do.
Did you come up with that really cute press release? The one about, you know, the
I didn't write it. I'm useless in prose, so I didn't write it. I'm not sure whether I think that press release is a good idea, but I thought, you know, what the hell. That's why I asked those two guys to write it.
Well, at least it was a change from the usual, you know, thing. At least it would confound some idiot who didn't know anything about the band. They would be like, oh, this is real.
So it's quite witty.
Some of the other songs on the album, I was curious about what was behind them, like the song Lucretia and Reflection. Did that have anything to do with her?
Yeah, that would seem like it's just sort of welcome on board and Patricia. So.
How about 1959? I mean, I read that was the year you were born. Is that some kind of statement on that? Was it like a play on that you'd done 1969?
Well, that was a sort of a nice little resonance, you know. There's a lot of hippie-driven music, particularly in England at the moment, about childhood and innocence, which I find.
Is that hippie music?
A lot of really wimpy dribble about innocence. I just want to make the point that from the day you're born, it's an illusion. Children, particularly, are very far from innocent.
Children are evil. Well, they can be evil. There's something very evil about them at times.
Those children are in the future at the moment.
At the same time, I remember I did feel pretty innocent.
It seems like everything is a paradox. There's always two sides to everything. All the songs and all the music and even your ideas on everything.
Well, like on the Reptile House, a lot of the songs seem to be like have two meanings.
Valentine is just one of the most amazing songs.
I think it's probably the most political song I ever wrote. That was the time when the royal wedding, it was Charles and Diana, was being used in British media to cover up the Falklands fiasco.
Do you have any particular favorites of your records? So that's my particular favorite, the Reptile House.
Yeah.
I just have a real fascination with that.
I think up until 1959, Fix was my favorite. I thought it was a very underrated song. It just had such a simple charm to it. Mm-hmm. And the recordings were pretty bad. That's just something. Bass riffs of all time. I don't know who wrote it first. Someone has that.
So I'm singing it in my head if it's the right song.
Yes.
That's it. I've been around singing that for days and days.
I love riffs like that. I could sit down and get someone who's playing for hours and then perfectly happy.
Well, it has a, like you said before, a hypnotic mantra-like quality where you can just listen to it and it almost lulls
the whole record.
One thing I'd like to get into is releasing tape loops. There's certain things I've done which I think would work really well as loops.
That's cool. Do you think, you ever might release things that are outside the auspices of the, you know, major record company, just like things that are more
familiar? The gift thing taught me a real lesson about how if you're not worried about making the next major successful sisters hit album, and you just go away for yourself 5 days studio time, just whack the stuff down at the top of your head, and sometimes taking it to high court. I thought, it's more effective just to put the record out and sell it.
listenable. Taught me a lesson which I haven't quite taken on board yet. But having done that and got away with it and not got sued by Warner,
good victory.
It was sweet at the time. I mean, it's not a major event in the history of the music industry. But, you know, I made my little point, and they certainly took me a lot more seriously afterwards.
Fans moved on to say that band we won't mention who emerged first, as opposed to where the Sisters went. Do you think they waited for Sisters?
Do you think they
jumped the board? Because we, you know, we also listen to the Mission.
I think there's something missing.
New stuff is horrible.
I think they did initially think, well, if the Mission's all there is, fine, we'll go for it. But I think increasingly now the Mission is, they have a very team.
Yeah,
do a lot of that sort of press, I think my people are back with me, and they have a whole separate new thing, which is why they're not really important to me anymore. I don't think we really sort of overlap.
They seem to me to be like a body without a head.
Yeah, they're very proficient, and I know someone that's heard their imminent album says it sounds like a very good record. Everything sounds great. It lacks central authority.
We can name the authority pretty easily.
Yeah, it's sitting right here.
It wouldn't have to be me. You know, it could be. There are a lot of people who are very fine lyricists and who have a vocal range like I would not believe, like far superior to mine, far superior. But you know, they've got a guitarist who wants to be a rock star. So. And to be fair to them, they're not interested in being great, they're interested in being adequately good to be really famous. That's what they want, that's what they've got. Fine, nobody has a problem with that, I don't have a problem with that.
Totally motivated by the dollar?
Yeah, increasingly by the dollar and less by the pound.
Well, that
sums it all up.
Is that had any reason why? I mean,
at least they're open about it.
Seemed like they were kind of pushing you at the end. I mean, you seemed to work more methodically and produced a really stellar work, whereas I don't think they had the same, so shall we put it, quality control.
They had to push me to go on stage, and I wouldn't have done tours about people, so maybe they'd be some good, because I did sort of enjoy aspects of the tour. But in terms of the records, they get to the studio, go to sleep, and I make a solid record. And when I got too sick to do that, making the last album, certain things did slip down. Certain things improved. I thought I was really proud of the fact that because I was so sick, suddenly other people in the band started to write some of the music. And I thought the music they wrote was pretty damn fine.
Yeah.
I was sad I hadn't had it before, but it happened.
That was something I was always curious about too. On the early records, the writing credits are all just Eldritch, and then on the album, it seemed like all of a sudden,
Marks, Eldritch,
it seemed like they wrote a lot. I mean,
I was very unwell. I really wasn't up to it. We did three major tours on Maiden album at the end.
That'll take a lot of it.
Feel vindicated at all when, I mean, it seemed like while the Sisters had been out of the spotlight, you know, that band we won't mention had got a lot of attention, and then it seemed like finally
if it hadn't been at my expense, but they said a lot of things about me which weren't remotely true, and that was very good, particularly to the people who work with me. I mean, I'm used to people saying all sorts of things about me, but because through the whole that period I decided I wasn't going to.
Did you feel good then when your record finally did come out and really played
it
well?
Because I thought it was a good record, not particularly because it was a successful record, but because I thought it was a good record. I wouldn't have minded if it hadn't charted anywhere in the world.
should stop thinking about it. And I think it's important to the people who stuck with me that there were letters coming during that time, so that doesn't matter much to you whether you put a record out ever again, probably, but it matters to us. So I was quite pleased with that because they, I know I was defended. A lot of people fought my corner for me at that time because I was too proud to get involved in it.
Yeah. It seemed like you mentioned in the press that it definitely seemed like this one would let them throw it all around, you laid low and let everyone else get hit.
But it certainly worked when the record did come out because they made me so famous in my absence by doing it to
constantly using your name when you weren't around. Yeah.
Yeah. Hopefully that'll be a bit different this time. Imagine they'll get asked sisters some questions and Eldritch questions just like I get asked visual questions. And, you know, they tend to do interviews drunk and I tend to do them sober, so.
That's right.
Who knows what they're going to say? These people have a big habit of talking on top of their head, you know. So.
My last question was, the song Neverland was one of my favorite things on the new record. But I was curious why it was such a, you know, it says a fragment, why was it so short? I mean, I would have liked
to... So much more, we just hungered for more at the end of that album.
That's, I think, the main thing that suffered with the album coming out before Christmas, as opposed to maybe working on it for like a Christmas, putting it out after Christmas. There is a long version of that song, which I never had time in the studio to sing properly, or get the piano down. I think it in itself still makes sense, is what you hear on the album. And to be fair, there's only so many minutes you can put on an album, and we already went over that. But there is a long version which incorporates what's on the album and makes a different sort of sense because of what's on the higher end of it. It's just that what's on the multi-track doesn't count at some stage. It was going to happen on the B-side of the medium, but someone said I got hold of the original multi-tracks of Dominion. A lot of outtakes and working bits. Shuffled them about, chopped them up, sped them up, slowed them down, and got some really interesting soundtrack into those things. And then there was one.
Choice of putting, don't call the name, the song off Sister, but on the disc recording, 12 inch.
Because nothing else was recorded in time. And I was very fond of Colours. I think it's one of the best things I'd ever written.
Right.
And I thought that there's a friend of mine that did the words for me on Gift. Really well. I thought, wow, I was aching to just put my own vocal on that. It sounds very similar, but just, I think it has a little extra something, which is worth doing to me. I'm very, very proud of that. There's so many strings coming from the choruses, there's some things happening there with the harmonics that I'm intensely proud of. This goes back to Elgar again, one of the weird E minor harmonics that runs through Elgar's best music.
I just remembered one other thing I was going to ask. Are you interested at all in Morricone? Because that song Phantom always kind of reminded me of some of his work, and then the look you had around the time of the first album seemed very Sergio Leone. I mean, is that anything you liked?
I thought Phantom was a great spaghetti western song. Yeah, it was on sort of Ghost Riders. It's the first time we ever had one of those tremolo arm things to play on the guitars. You know, like every time you have to make a record, you go around town desperately borrowing guitars. But unfortunately, we got one with one of these tremolo. It was weird things start happening in the studio. So I'm like, take that.
Exhausted our questions.
I still respect the Banshees. I think they're a good band.
You know, I can't respect the Furs at all. His attitude is unbelievable. When I decided to make $3 and get something like that, and then go back to doing what he does the best. But I think it's a good round to get back to doing what he does best, just yet. So it's like a few more dollars and I'm beginning to get suspicious. But I think he could be the finest lyricist to him.
Probably was. I mean, I love
still doing it. It's so frustrating when it doesn't apply himself.
The first two albums are just so intense.
It's good.
I don't know, lately it's just a little too diluted for me.
Yeah.
The intensity is diluted.
Pop records, very pop records.
Seriously? They just don't forget, you know, they say something like that. You just don't do that, you know?
Well, that's good, because maybe that way, you know, they'll realize that they can't just...
It's a long process.
And the next time you want funds to use, get the recording equipment you want, you have to go through Meatloaf's man.
That's possible. Well, that was fun. It was the first time I worked with that song producer. I actually finished the project without fire.
Who was the producer that had fire?
This hall, I'm gonna make a right. Go straight across to the next. Thank you.